or an Ola ride. How many of you have watched the latest Sacred Games or whatever else that you watch on Netflix? How many of you watched Netflix? I think, you know, there is no debate about it, but Chris insisted that we debate, so we are debating today. Just kidding. Artificial intelligence is an ever-pervasive. Each one of our lives have been touched by it, and we are the urban population, right? Right from when you shop on Amazon or a Flipkart or any other online forum to the recommendations that come for you, to booking your Uber rides, to even calculating the distance that you are, you know, your Google Maps tells you, or, you know, the speed at which that you're driving. You know, some of the new phones have that feature as well, which can tell you the speed at which you are driving, and especially with today's state of fines and stuff like that, you know, that's a very handy feature as well. To the way you get entertained today, each one of us get entertained today, it's absolutely on demand, cater to the taste that each one of us has. AI has made it all possible. We couldn't even think of that, and some of us have grown in the Doordarshan era. Imagine how entertainment was back then to, you know, the era of Tata Skies when, you know, you saw 100 channels and we were like, wow, to now everything is on demand and absolutely catered to your needs. How fantastic is that? And how did that happen? Through AI. So I don't even see a reason, you know, to debate on whether AI is good or bad. It's absolutely good. The kind of personalization that it brings, the kind of richness that it brings, and this is, I'm just talking about the urban lives. Now let's talk about, you know, the other industries or the other, you know, the larger areas. In the field of agriculture, agriculture and, you know, first let's talk closer home. Today, AI has enabled farmers in India to absolutely predict the kind of yield they will have, especially in, you know, in areas where are very, very dependent on rains, places like Nagpur, for example. So the farmers know exactly the kind of oranges that they'll be able to grow and the kind of yield they will be able to predict the yield and so on. Their lives have completely changed because of that. Also, again, you know, in that sector, which was always kind of deprived, stroke manipulated, you know, they are the lowest of the in the supply chain, if you will. Tractors, I mean, that industry relies heavily on tractors and stuff like that, right? The agriculture, you know, our farmers in our country. And if those tractors break down, I don't know how to fix my car breaks down. But imagine if those tractors break down, they really get fleeced by, you know, the middlemen and all the kinds of people in between to kind of get those things fixed. But Eicher, who's the leading tractor company in India, has now enabled through IoT devices, and you know that's possible through the technology that we have today because of the analytics and so on as well, to do predictive maintenance on those tractors. So, you know, the farmers get an alert on their phone saying that it seems like, you know, you need to do a certain tuning this way, that way, you know, this is our technician, will help you. So the lives are absolutely getting disrupted, and for a positive reason. Elsewhere, again in the same industry, for example, you know, in Japan, where you know, people are very, very passionate about agriculture again, and they really take pride in the quality of their produce. They really, really take pride in the quality of their produce. They've been able to multiply their produce multiple factor of times by using AI, just by, you know, tuning some of those parameters that kind of, you know, go into building that produce. So just to say that AI is evil, it's not even a case in point, Chris. I think it's the great thing that has happened. Our lives have changed for the good, and they will continue to evolve and change, you know, is what I would say.
Okay. Chris is against the proposition. So Chris, your time.
Yes. Thank you all. Thank the audience. Thank AIM for putting this together, and I thank my esteemed and much more qualified than me opponent, Anshu. Thank you. Having said that, Anshu, I think you're looking at this with gilded eyes. There are a lot of bad things going on with AI. We talk about how AI is increasing jobs, but if you look at the bulk of the jobs, Times of India just last week reported that there are 1 lakh open jobs, 100,000 jobs, right now that are overwork engineers are going to transfer to and make enough money to survive on. This is very low level, mind numbing, boring work, tagging items, looking at pictures in order to teach AI. So you can imagine sitting at your screen and circling a stoplight. Of course, I forget I'm in Bangalore, so I think I needed to define what a stoplight is. You know when you go to that intersection in Mahadevapura or Maleshwaram and there's that big bright thing in the sky? That is not a Diwali celebration light. Secondly, AI is wrong. AI is often wrong. You look at Google's new photo blending. Both Anshu and I are amateur photographers. Their new photo blending tool confuses people with mountains. AI is wrong. I won't mention the company, but initials IBM. Their AI product was used last year in a hospital in the state of Florida, in my native, and the doctors referred to it as a piece of lungi because it was incorrectly calculating everything. Now, of course, there are a lot of accidents with self-driving cars. And we're a long way from making that happen, although I will give it to the self-driving car. The reason they're involved in so many accidents where they're found at fault is because they cannot predict irrational human behavior. So finally, AI is lumpy. And what I mean by that is that there's this huge rush now to grab on something that looks like AI. If you look at AIM, and they look at the trajectory, you know, over 50 or about 50% of the world's analysts are right here in India with exponential growth rate since I moved to India in 2014. There's been an exponential growth rate of analysts in the country. And you look at just the last year, all of the analytic acquisitions that took place, Tableau and Click and Google, everything is moving right now. And yet, where are we going? Oh, there's a big race, and I fear that we don't understand where the AI train is going. So what I mean by lumpy is I am not on Facebook. I use a secure browser. I use secure email. I have a VPN. I am like mysterious on the web. And yet every time I go into Google, and I turned off Siri, and yet every time I go into the map to Google to see how long it's going to take me to get to Kempe Gowda Airport, it's saying, you're going to miss your flight. So Google knows where I am, even though I have all these protections. Yet my bank, whose name I won't mention, but its initials are HDFC, I have been a customer of HDFC since 2014. Do they know me? Illa? Gotilla. So I log on, I put in my name, I put in my password, and then, you know, you have to click on the little thing with your little sign. And then they, do I get in? No. So then they ask me my favorite dessert, gulab jamun. My favorite vacation place, Goa. Does it let me get to my account? No. Why? Because then starts death by OTP. A virtuously endless cycle. So, Anshu, AI is not there. And I would argue AI is not good, and it's actually evil.
Okay, so it's Anshu's time to counter Chris. Anshu, your comments on that.
Yes. So don't get charmed by his, charm. Of course, he's very charming. All right. But Chris, all that you said, right, are the practitioners' point of view, and I somewhat agree with you, but that doesn't mean that AI is evil, right? It's gonna get there someday. It takes a while, it takes iterations and so on. It's exactly like how, you know, when back in India, about 35 years back, when computers started to come in India, everybody was scared about the jobs. Everybody was scared that, you know, my job is gonna go away. But look at what has happened, right? It has created a very different cross-section of society, which is educated, which is absolutely computer literate, and it put us instead in, you know, and the IT revolution was able to happen at that point in time. So just this view that AI is going to come and take my jobs away, that's not happening. And in fact, you know, yesterday, a bunch of us were discussing about exactly that, and, you know, there is a friend of ours who has successfully sold his product company to a large company just on that premise where parts of AI will get automated. You will have a machine do that, but there'll be a large value that you will still require decisions to be programmed by algorithms to be created by individuals, and that's where you know the investment should go in. So I don't agree to your view of you know the jobs is going to go away. Coming to the intuitiveness or the not so intuitiveness of those the banks that you work with, and I don't know why would you work with those banks, but that's the customer experience. I think. There is so much of AI that can be applied there to kind of enhance customer experience. On the positive side, when you know there are hotels who deploy some of these AI techniques, where your welcome experience is completely different. You know, the level of personalization that you can go to, etc., and they take it to several notches up. And likewise, you can deploy it in any of your shopping experience and so on. So I think that's the positive side, and AI is enabling that. So you need to come out of your dark zone, Chris.
So Chris, can you explain the proposition?
Yeah, thank you. So let me explain why I'm against the proposition that AI is good. First one is Cambridge Analytica. And thankfully, we have a couple of whistleblowers, so now we know exactly what happened. Now, in terms of influencing my presidential election and the UK's Brexit election, I'm sure nothing like that would ever happen in this country, right? Now, you could argue that Christopher Wiley and Rebecca Kaiser were not evil, but they certainly were naive. And they didn't control their algorithms. Now, the people they worked for, the CEO, Steve Bannon, and the Mercers, probably were evil. And they took advantage of this power and used it for evil purposes. So that's just one example. Secondly, when you think about AI used for war, and recently, there have been a lot of articles about the AI arms race between China and the USA. And many times, it feels very familiar to me. It feels like the nuclear arms race, where in the general Jack Shannon, who's in charge of US Army AI, his whole reason of existence is to compete against an unknown AI force. Now, China is concerned about the US because we're really good in strategy games and we have really strong AI. And US is afraid of China because China is a monolithic control over data and technology. And yet, we're operating from a place of fear, and these people are building things for war that they don't really understand. And so the difference between this and the nuclear race, and which is I always say that data is not the new oil, data is uranium, because it feels that big and that powerful and that dangerous. But at least when we were going through the nuclear arms race, we had the mad mutual assured destruction. Well, how does an AI get scared? How does an AI that makes a decision in a thousandth of a second based on some quantitative variable, I don't trust that we'll have any control over that. And the last thing that I'll mention about why AI is evil, and we talk about people who are digitally connected and how much it helps them, there's a whole population in the world, almost 40% of the world is not digitally connected, and a lot of those people are in this country today. And these people are all going to be impacted by AI. Decisions are going to be made about them, they're going to be marketed to, they're going to be influenced by their government using the AI, and yet they're completely ignorant and not understanding. So from those perspectives, that's why I think AI is not good, and in fact, I think AI is evil.
Can we take some questions? Okay, no. Audience, your time to ask questions.
So Chris, the question is, should we just stop?
Well, it's out of the bag. So I don't think we should stop. but I do have some ideas, which I'll talk about in the next section, of what we should do.
Yeah, let me answer that. And you know, to Chris, to your earlier points on Cambridge Analytica and others, to me, I draw a parallel to nuclear technology. The nuclear technology was built for something good, and it was also used for something, you know, absolutely, yeah, I'll use the word evil at that point in time, right? It's about how you implement it. Does that mean the technology is bad? Absolutely not. So I think, you know, analytics or AI is on the similar zone. What you use it for and what it can get used for, you know, our imagination is the, you know, we are only limited by our imagination. And Cambridge Analytica did whatever people could, I mean, nobody else could think of, and people actually voluntarily gave all those data to them while playing those silly games on Facebook, yeah. Right? You didn't even realize how that was going to get used. So I don't think the that makes the technology evil. The technology is available, just like the nuclear technology was available. What you do with that is what you decide to do with that is your thing.
To your right, I would like to think of AI like a knife. You can use a knife to do a surgery, or make food, or violence, okay? In my mind, there needs to be some kind of guardrails to make it actually good or evil, because it's just a tool. It's neither good nor evil. It's the user of the tool who is making it good or evil. So in your mind, can you think of some guardrails, either from a modeler perspective or from a regulation perspective, that can help it become more good and less evil?
Yeah, I certainly can, and let me hold that for my summary section, but absolutely, I agree. I would say, though, it's different than a knife, because it both has broad impact, but also unintended impact. And at some level, you get down into machine learning, and it's not like logistic regression, where you're controlling every variable. I mean, machine learning, the computer's driving the boat, whether it's unsupervised or supervised, and that's where my concern is. You really don't know what's going on there. So I think both from a perspective of impact, but also the unintended consequences.
So, yes, Anshu, a point and a question, right, Anshu? So you were talking about people collecting data from all the silly games you play. I mean, there's an easy way to work around it. That's the reason why I visit a few interesting websites, so just to throw the marketers off, but leaving that aside. The point about evil, and I think he made a good point, right? And you alluded to the whole concept of new technology. Nuclear technology was designed for doing good, but was used for doing evil. The difference is it was consciously used for evil, right? And I want your point of view on, and a lot of what Chris talks about AI being evil is ignorant use of AI. I mean, like, how much of it is AI being developed by the ignoramus that is creating the evil, and how much of it is a conscious choice of using AI for evil? If you can make the distinction between those two, right? Because I'm talking about AI built by somebody who really doesn't understand how AI works, which is essentially, do you eat a meal cooked by a dilettante, or do you eat a meal cooked by a cordon bleu trained chef? And how much of the evil facet of AI is coming from people who are developing AI who really don't know what it can do? And just your thoughts on that, because I don't see it as a conscious choice of, I'm not sitting here writing an AI to do evil, right?
Yep.
How much of the evil is unintended?
Yeah, so I'll give you an example. Evil is a pretty strong word, so let's keep that out of it. But imagine it's a self-driving car, and the car crashes, God forbid, crashes a child. Who do you blame? You blame the car? You blame the child? What would you try to save? You would try to save, in India you blame Modi, yeah, okay.
Donald Trump.
Now, then you try to upgrade the algorithm to kind of, for the car. Now, your decision making completely changes when you have another dimension added to it. If the person who came in front of the car is a small child, they know it completely changes. And if it's somebody you know, and or your own child, then the whole principle of moral ethics, everything else, completely changes in how you would program that situation and how you would view that situation. So yes, the unintended use, and I think that's where, while the nuclear you know, analogy was very analog in that sense, whereas, you know, the world of AI is so pervasive, and that's what I said, that, you know, it is so pervasive, and there are a lot of things that you cannot control, but it needs to be thought through. It does need to be thought through. Does that make the technology evil or bad? No, it does not. Right.
Okay.
Chris, I have a question.
Sorry, have a question here. Yeah. My question is similar to what my friends have asked here. So, in 17th and 18th century is considered as a boom in industrial revolution. And that time it was celebrated to, the maximum extent. But now when you see it this 21st century, we do have lots of, bad impacts which the industrial revolution has caused. And now we are trying to tackle all the environment pollution and, all the, bad effects which has come out of this industrial revolution, which was once considered as a boom, maybe in the 17th or 18th centuries. Now the United Nations is asking every country to pay a carbon credit and to restrict the carbon emissions which you send out to the air. And there are lots of restrictions which are coming up. The BS6, which India has, BS6 motor norms, which India has, implemented now. Likewise, do you think that artificial intelligence, which is considered as a boom now, will be maybe a century later, is going to have this kind of an impact? Or should we put a cap or ceiling for the development? Which is because now we say that, okay, automate everything, whatever you have. But should we, foresee that what could be the bad impacts which can happen in the near future? Do you think that we should put a cap or ceiling now itself?
Pretty good question, actually. I don't think there is a cap or ceiling that is, that can be put on any development and technology and so on. It cannot be, right? You cannot really control it. But what you can do is you can regulate, and that's where, the data regulations that the world is working towards, including India, there are 27 different countries who have signed up for that, is working towards, would make some sense, because you need to exactly, and to to the earlier question as well, there needs to be, and I'm kind of resisting to use the word a council or a cohort or whatever, right? Set of 10 people or 15 people cannot really form the rules and regulations for the world. But there needs to be a conscious call made on how this can be used so that, you don't end up with a Cambridge Analytica sort of event elsewhere as well, which really, really actually...
Yes.
It was a game changer for the world. It was truly a game changer for the world.
Yes,
so that does not happen again.
My question is mainly into the field of defense when because we had a morning, we had another session where they were speaking about the implementing artificial intelligence in the field of defense. So in developing weapons. So, and right now, none of this United Nations or this international organization has really looked into artificial intelligence and their disadvantages that it might cause to the world. So we still are not there. We are still developing. We still, the United States has already started implementing artificial intelligence in developing their weapons. Once it was atom bomb. Once it was the science, they have implemented atom bomb and it affected very badly. And then all the nuclear, non-NBPT, which came into existence, which no countries should use atom bombs or nuclear bombs anymore. So this is not happening. So can we have, my question is, this kind of, initiative from international organizations or something that, okay, don't use it in defense, or don't use it to create biomedical weapons.
You can't stop.
I think we need to, and I'm gonna go back to your original question about the Industrial Revolution and comparing that to the AI revolution, and you said in 100 years. So if we are around in 100 years, I think is the real question. But when you look at a revolution, an industrial revolution, the one thing that's clear is the people on the top of the economy do really well. And the people down at the bottom of the economy do really poorly. And then what you see is a mix in the middle. So in the first industrial revolution, It was the tradespeople who were replaced by manufacturing. And in our coming revolution, it's going to be this new class of low-end jobs that I talked about. You don't need that many modelers. At the end of the day, algorithms, especially when you get into machine learning, and the algorithms are creating themselves, you don't need a lot of modelers. You need a lot of people to help identify and help teach AI, but the people in the middle are going to be the Uber drivers, very clearly are working towards eradicating all of their labor problems by going to self-driving vehicles, but also the engineers are going to be impacted as well. So I did not put her in the audience, but I'm glad she's here.
Just a small comment. Why can't we look at this debate using AI itself? You know, like I was just imagining, can we debate whether good is good, or evil good is good, or evil is good, or good evil is good. So if you apply that way, so evil, you
then
can...
Then would you have come?
Yeah, you can take it out.
Yeah.
I agree with Anshu on this this matter. I think artificial intelligence is always better than natural stupidity. Okay, I think that definitely is the case. And like he said, I think there's nothing good and evil, and your guns argument is not correct though. The fact that guns don't kill people. AI, I think, will continue to be created the way it's created, and I think it's given tremendous benefits. So, Chris, you're completely wrong.
But AI
I
does kill
that
people.
Either.
That's the difference. AI does kill people.
Chris,
do we have time? Okay.
Yeah, Chris. I think you know you have a fear about you know AI algorithms being in a black box that we don't know what's going you know inside,
yeah.
Right? But
yeah.
There are some efforts to make AI more explainable these days, right? So if we can make the models more explainable, then will you be comfortable you know to go with AI?
I think explainable is not enough, and I'll touch upon that right now, I think, yeah? Do I go?
That's a great
So
That's
thank
a,
you.
Yes.
Yes, Chris, can we just take one last question because
yeah.
He already raised his hand.
So this is a pretty light question for Anshu. So have you seen web series or like the series Black Mirror? If yes, oh.
No, I haven't seen.
Oh, okay. So it looks at the dark side of all the technology. So probably you can have a look at that. Thanks.
I have a question. Can I ask? Okay, the last question, I promise. When I think about artificial intelligence in India, I am not worried that jobs will be lost, new set of jobs will be created, but there's only going to be a section of people who will be able to do those jobs. And the people who lose those jobs, then this creates more social disparity in this country, and you've seen it in, I don't want to quote these countries, but Syria, even to a certain extent in Kashmir, when there is unemployment, then it's not just an employment. It goes to the next level of extremism, people being able to influence because they are not a part of mainstream, them feeling, you know, they've been put out of the society because the rich people have something better to do. So is it, I mean, where are we going as a society when something like this comes up?
So I don't think AI is causing any of that, right? The economic slowdown that you see in India, trust me, is not because of AI.
No, that
so let's first stay with that. Let's agree on that first of all. But yes, to your original point that you know there would be different jobs created. People would aspire to do something else. They're not going to be doing the same routine automation in the name of automation. It's not going to be if there is a bad process, just by automating or digitizing that bad process, you don't make it a good process, right? It's not a good customer experience. So you'll be thinking about doing different things. And today that has already happened. There are schools that have already started to offer AI, I won't call it courses, but AI or machine learning or analytics sort of flavors right from class 7th, 8th grade. Similarly, and I go back to the same example because when I was growing up, computers were still coming into India. They were absolutely coming in and it was fascinating to start learning. And when my brother who was few years my junior, he did it in class 2, what I did it in class 10 perhaps, from a computer science perspective. And you know, just that native feel of that, and then it becomes a part of you. Then you don't feel that there's something alien and so on. Whereas my father, it took him a long time to kind of, you know, start even, you know, hitting his fingers on the keyboard. So that revolution is going to happen. And that change is going to happen in the society. That does not mean that we are going to go back in time. Today we don't, but is the journey on? Absolutely yes. Absolutely yes.
Chris, I have one question.
Okay.
Would there be, you know, in future, would there be a time where we have absolutely no control over AI? And in fact, Elon Musk has already written in his documentaries, and I would like to ask the question, could AI be the next, I mean, the world's first immortal dictator?
Well, I mean, we have examples of this today. I mean, just at a theoretical level, we know that unsupervised learning models, we have no idea what they're doing. We know what the outcome is, but we don't know what they're doing. And I'll just give the example of Facebook had two chatbots, and they had the chatbots talking to each other, and they started creating their own language. Now, they were able to unplug those, but I think it's at this time. But you know, think about distributed architecture and how anyone can create an AI and there's no control over it, there's no way to identify it. At least with a nuclear weapon, they have to bring in the radioactive material and they need a big station to process it. And we can often spot that in satellites. But AI, someone could be sitting at Cafe Coffee Day writing a code. So I think it is a very real danger.
Okay, so summary time. Who goes first? Chris, Anshu,
yeah,
please summarize.
I'll go first. So I do have a solution to combat the evil AI. The first one, as you've mentioned, is regulation. Now, I was having this conversation with our colleague Subo, and I don't trust the government of Karnataka. I don't think we actually have a government in Karnataka right now. nor do I trust the government of Alabama. I don't trust the United Nations, which could be, or some other multinational. He suggests that we have a distributed network of regulation, being able to bring in the expertise, people who really understand AI, to validate and to watch over these models. But I think it needs to be something that's done at a global level, and so we can exert control over it. The second thing is my message to all of you, and very similar to what you just asked about, is that, you know, the Cambridge Analytica people came out as whistleblowers because, and if you've watched any of their videos or listened to any of their interviews, they are depressed people today because of what they did. So my request of you is don't become a whistleblower. Exercise your ethical responsibilities now and be aware of not only what that model's doing, but also what the unintended consequences might be. I don't think it's enough for analysts just to churn out code. I think we need to take responsibility for that. And to your point, I think that we as analysts need to understand who are the people that are digitally illiterate and understand what we could do. And I'll just put a plug in for some of the work that I've been doing now. But at the end of the day, machine learning is just probability and statistics. And yet so many of the people in the world don't understand this. And we've all had really bad statistics professors or teachers. So I've been working on a class to teach kids in government schools using marbles, using dice, and using height charts to have really interesting conversations about probability and statistics. And the third thing is, to your point, I don't think explainability is enough. You know, the emphasis right now, everyone's trying to explain these black boxes. The GDPR, when you look at their regulations, it just says the model needs to be explainable. So how are we explaining these black box algorithms? We're using another model to explain it. So we might be able to describe the output, but we have no idea what's going on in that box. And explaining it by using another algorithm is not going to be able to identify the unintended consequences. So what we need to work towards is a true understanding of what that model's doing. And I would say that it's not about explainability, it's about interpretability. And it's not about just doing machine learning because it's easier and it's faster. We have this assumption that if it's complicated, it's good. But a lot of the things that we come up against, you really don't know that. So I think that we need to be wise about selecting machine learning, and when we do it, it needs to be interpretable, not just explainable.
I wouldn't disagree to a couple of things that he said. So in my summary, I would say the use of AI and what the possibilities that AI has is something that we've never witnessed before, and it's just incremental, and it's only going to go exponential from here. Because data is democratized, it's our data, it's each one of our data, and also, you know, the different data sets that we all, you know, would work with, et cetera, yes, it does place an ethical responsibility. So in that sense, the nuclear, you know, example is off, because, you know, that's a very, very privately controlled space. But this is, so each one of us, if we know, if we are working on problems, and if we know that, you know, that's not being used for the right thing, I think each one of us has this responsibility to blow the whistle and call out that this is not being used for the right direction. And also that, yes, the regulations need to come in place, how data gets utilized, because every single moment, right, even as we speak right now, there is a ton of data about this conference, you know, getting out. Each one of us are voluntarily putting out stuff and so on. So you cannot really control the data proliferation. But what we can control is how that data can get utilized and what you do with that. But again, you know, if we can fix some of this, and if we can put that framework in place, the opportunities and the benefits of AI are absolutely they're just unsurmountable. And I think we are in that zone, and we are fortunate. And this is, you know, world-changing events that we are all witnessing as we kind of go about with our lives, as we have seen how our lives have changed, and, you know, how it's impacting the next generation. So that's what I would say.
I think that was a great debate. We must give both of them a big round of applause for that. Thank you so much.